Denver 7 On Demand is brought to you by Ferguson and BAC Appliance Center, the best in bath, kitchen, and lighting for your home.
Good morning, I'm Molly Hendrickson.
And I'm Brian Sanders. Here's the latest from Denver 7. Today, RTD's top leader will have a conference call with leaders of the Federal Railroad Administration to give an update on the long-delayed G-Line to Wheat Ridge and Arvada.
Problems at the crossing gates along the A-Line out to DIA have had a domino effect on opening the G-Line. Denver 7's Eric Lufer shows us why RTD is optimistic for the progress on both lines.
And changes are already going to start at 3 a.m. next Friday. All 9 crossings in Denver, including this one at 40th and York, will become quiet zones. While the bells will still ring at each crossing, the trains will stop blaring their horns unless they see something or someone on the tracks. So where are we at with the A-Line and G-Line? 144 trains are running each weekday along the A-Line. The flaggers at the A-Line crossings are gone. Quiet zones will start in Denver on March 1st. However, Aurora doesn't have quiet zones yet, so the train horns will still blast at 2 crossings through Aurora. As for the G-Line, flaggers are still in place at 16 crossings. Trains are running on a 777 schedule, meaning 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., 7 days a week. And remember, that's just testing. You won't be able to ride until RTD gets several more approvals, and there are no quiet zones yet, so neighbors are hearing the train horns from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. The question now, when will the G-Line through Wheat Ridge and Arvada actually get going where the public can take the train? RTD still saying they don't know yet. I'm Eric Lufer, Denver 7.
Our phones were ringing nonstop last night from Denver 7. Viewers asking why helicopters were flying overhead nonstop last night. Westminster and Arvada police tweeted out saying the helicopters were from the Army performing flight operations near Rocky Mountain Airport. They say operations could continue for a few weeks to come, but we reached out to Buckley Air Force Base, who says the Army National Guard does fly helicopters for routine training sessions, but the ones last night were not from them. They're going to continue to look at where the helicopters were coming from.
Castle Rock is switching to a toilet-to-tap water method in an effort to preserve our resources. Through this process, treated wastewater will be released into a creek, then cycled through and purified again before being sent back through the faucets. City leaders say despite what some people may think of this process, the system is proven to be effective and safe.
Everybody lives downstream of somebody.
Yeah.
And they're reusing that water all the time.
For the last decade, the city of Aurora has been using this method for its water. There is an open house this Saturday for Castle Rock residents to learn more about the process.
Our state lawmakers are moving forward with a bill to help all working families, especially working women. Micah Smith explains how a new bill would change the salary conversation.
Equal pay for equal work. A Colorado bill aimed at bridging the gender pay gap in our state passed the Senate Judiciary Committee this week. According to the bill's sponsors and the Women's Foundation of Colorado, in our state, on average, women make 86 cents per every dollar a man earns. But the pay gap is even wider for women of color. Black women make 63 cents for every dollar, and Latino women make 53 cents for every dollar a man earns doing the same work. The bill would put safeguards in place to change this. It would stop employers from asking about pay from previous jobs, but require them to post a pay scale for open positions. For employees who feel they're receiving unfair pay, this bill would allow them to take legal action. The bill now heads to the Senate Appropriations Committee for consideration. Reporting in Denver, Micah Smith, Denver 7.
An emotional reunion at Fort Carson today for the families of 55 soldiers deployed to Iraq last May. They were tasked with caring for sick, injured, and wounded members of our armed services overseas. A homecoming ceremony for the soldiers is being held at 2:30 this afternoon at the William Reed Special Events Center. And also today at Fort Carson, more than 80 employers from several different industries are looking for a few good men and women. A hiring event is happening at the Hub Building from 10 to 3. It's open to active service members, reservists, National Guardsmen, veterans, and military spouses. In addition to your resume, make sure you bring your ID. You'll need that to get onto the base.
Despite the recent teacher strike in Denver and teacher pay protests last April at the state capitol, many kids still want to be teachers. A conference starts tonight at the University of Northern Colorado to let future teachers learn more about the profession.
An idea for what teaching is about and let them see how wonderful it is to become a teacher.
Fueling that teacher pipeline and getting highly qualified teachers into classrooms all over.
More than 500 people are expected to attend the free conference tonight and tomorrow. This year's event is full, but if you're interested in attending next year, reach out to the College of Education at the University of Northern Colorado. Teachers in Denver just got a big boost to help in the classroom. Denver Public Schools Foundation announced it's given more than $79,000 to 56 teachers for this semester. Teachers can use the money for things like classroom materials or even field trip funding. Since it started in 2006, the foundation has given almost $1.9 million in grants.
The FDA is putting states like Colorado on alert when it comes to lax laws for vaccinations. Denver 7's Nicole Brady shows us what the agency worries may happen if something doesn't change.
Colorado is one of just 17 states that allow a personal belief exemption for vaccinations in addition to medical and religious exemptions. In an interview with CNN, the FDA chief accused these states of creating the opportunity for nationwide disease outbreaks. Measles was declared eliminated in the U.S. in 2000, but in recent years we have seen sporadic outbreaks. A bad one, of course, this year centered in Washington state. And Washington's legislature is currently considering removing the personal belief exemption for vaccinations. No such effort is being made right now in Colorado. On the other hand, though, vaccination rates in Colorado are improving. In 2013, we ranked 45th in the country for immunization rates. And back then, only 82% of kindergartners were vaccinated against measles. Last year, the state health department reported a vaccination rate of 93% among school-age children. And you can look up your school district's vaccination and exemption rates on the Colorado Department of Public Health website. We don't expect any mandate from the federal government to come immediately. If and when it happens, it will likely be challenged because this issue has so long been left up to the states. I'm Nicole Brady, Denver 7.
Meanwhile, social media companies are now stepping in to try and stop the spread of misinformation on vaccines. Pinterest has stopped returning search results for vaccine stories, and Facebook is looking to change their algorithm.
If you have a mortgage on your home, you know the monthly payments can crush your budget for years and years, but there are things you can do now to pay off your loans early and save money on the interest. Mortgage broker Ray Williams says you can try recasting your mortgage. Essentially, that's putting an additional down payment on your principal.
Call your servicer and engage with them through that process and have them recalculate your principal and interest without refinancing and taking on the costs of refinancing and then pay it off faster.
Ray says you can also try paying more than you have to, because adding just over 8% to your monthly payment will help you pay off your mortgage nearly 5 years faster.
If you are a parent who's new to our Colorado, you need to know now is the time to start registering for summer camps. Many camps like sailing and stand-up paddleboarding with Community Sailing of Colorado open registration in January and February.
Some families and parents really like to make sure that they get on top of that and they have that scheduled, so their summer plans are already kind of done and already taken care of. Don't get me wrong, I get the families that reach out to me in May, say, holy cow, we got to figure out what to do with the kids in the summer.
And you can learn more about summer camps and other great family activities at Family Fest this Saturday at the National Western Complex. That event runs from 11 to 5. It's $15 for adults. Kids are free with a paid adult.
Well, we are thinking warm thoughts because it is still cold out there, Lisa.
Yeah, good try, right? It's not going to help us much. It's going to stay pretty chilly. We're under a little bit of cloud cover here in town this morning, and the mountains are in for some pretty heavy snow. We're tracking a storm that's moving in from the southwest. It's bringing snow to parts of Nevada, down and through Las Vegas, getting some pretty good snow totals down there, a good 1 to 3 inches and some winter weather advisories. And this storm is going to move into southwestern Colorado, bringing some heavy snow in through our San Juans. Here in town, we're expecting a little increase in cloud cover today. Low 30s for highs this afternoon, so still about 15 degrees below normal. Cold tomorrow. Overnight tonight into tomorrow, with that increase in clouds, we could see an icy mix through the early morning drive. So we're going to have to watch for an icy commute in spots on Friday. Light snow possible between Friday and early Saturday. It looks like about 1 to 2 inches here in town, so it's not heavy, but it's enough that the roads could get icy. Skies will clear out on Saturday, upper 30s, but the winds will pick up as that storm moves out of the state, but things will warm up. And look at how much better it is early next week. We're going from 30s today to some low 50s, it looks like, you guys, by Monday.
All right. Thanks, Lisa. Our state wildlife officials are currently working hard to make sure a bald eagle gets rehabbed back to full health.
That eagle was injured inside a culvert at 11 Mile State Park, just west of Colorado Springs. Crews had to use a fishing net and a sled to pull the eagle through the deep snow back to safety, but the eagle is expected to make a full recovery.
And this has been your Denver 7 On Demand update. Thanks for joining us.
Check back here later today for another update and download the Denver 7 app for breaking news and alerts. Have a great day.